Okay. So, can anyone remind us what we covered in the other sessions that we've done on this so far? Anything at all? Harry, do you remember anything we were doing on Thursday?
Something looking at rights and the history of
the history of rights. Yeah.
Come from and the different organisations.
Yep, we did. We looked at certain organisations.
And the three, sort of three tiers that protect us.
Yep.
In the UK.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so
we've got the first one, then we've got that in between one, then we've got the human rights one.
Yeah, so we've got the Universal Declaration.
The European Convention, and then there's the British Human Rights
one. Yeah, great. So, yeah, we've got those, that triple lock, supposedly. And so that was the law part of things. Does anyone remember what was the controversy, or how did that centre around the background of human rights as an idea, as a philosophical concept?
It came from like that Persian text, and then it was the French Revolution, and it was the European Convention thing.
Yeah, so it came through which kind of part of the world, might we say?
Religion.
Religion, yeah. Which religion specifically?
Is Christianity it and Greek, like democracy.
Yeah, so it was argued that it was a Western construct, and we're going to look into some critiques of that today. That's what today's lesson is about, the criticisms of human rights. Philosophical criticisms, should I say. So we looked at the idea that it's a Western construct. What was kind of the saving grace that I tried to put? There's an idea that it transcends all that.
It's changed. Is that thing at the end of that book that we read?
Yeah, Ignatieff. Yeah. So the fact that it might have started off from Western origins, but it's become such a global phenomenon that more people can relate to human rights than can relate to any single religion or political idea. And that it...
It's like common universal. It's like a global...
Yeah. Yeah, because it's not partial. It's kind of... It takes the lowest kind of denominator of what it means to be a human.
How are you doing the lesson that we missed?
No.
After this... Because we'd missed
on the Tuesday. There would to be a lesson on the Tuesday.
No, the one that you did with Harry last week, we did it in the second hour.
No, Harry did the second hour of...
What we did.
Yeah.
Alright.
Yeah, so none of you have done this.
Right.
What I'm doing today is the third part of this human rights lesson. And I'll get to that in a second. But what this is about deeper criticisms of human rights in general. And as I've said in future ones, there's a lot of text on here, so I don't expect to try and write it down, because again, it's me kind of thinking on the page. But hopefully we'll get some good discussions going, and you can sort of get the gist down of what's happening. And again, this will be, it'll be on Moodle and so all this, so just let me skip where we've been. So we're looking at all this stuff, we've all done this together. Ignatieff, that's where we kind of finished, I believe. Yeah, Ignatieff. So, just moving on from that then. So we got Ignatieff and him sort of saying that it's this global idea. What I want to move on is some deeper criticism, some pre-human rights criticisms of the idea of rights as it was developing from the French Revolution, upon which human rights is developed today. So again, as I say, there's a lot of writing in some of these texts, but just try and take the gist of what I'm saying or the idea. I suppose that's a bit more like a university way of doing things. So, criticisms of human rights then. Jeremy Bentham. We have mentioned Jeremy Bentham before. Does anyone remember anything to a bit of revision? Does anyone remember where we came across Bentham?
In the beginning of the crime module?
Yeah, so he was the idea of...
He was an against, wasn't he? Or far off. Against, like... The idea of crime or something.
He was for the idea of he came up with this idea of the panopticon, which is a prison where you can be watched at all times. So he wrote on all kinds of issues, but one something else which he wrote on, and I suppose the main thing is that phrase nonsense on stilts, that's a key quote of his. So Bentham was living around that time, 1795, which was around the time of the French Revolution. And the French Revolution, the droit des hommes, French is out of pronunciation's wrong there, but the rights of man. So Bentham was kind of a, and I mean this in the broadest sense of the word, he was a conservative figure. He liked tradition, he liked kings and queens and all that kind of stuff. We would call that right wing today, yeah. In fact, that's when you were, maybe people called him that then, because it was the French Revolution that gave birth to the left and the right, as in who sat on what side of the court. But yeah, he is a right wing thinker, he's a conservative thinker, right? But he was a philosopher, and his main idea was that rights is just nonsense on stilts. It's just something that's made up, which of course it is made up in a sense. But his idea was that just because the French Revolution happens, just because people claim that they have rights, doesn't mean that they actually do have rights. What he reached back for was the idea that only governments, when you're talking, it was also almost a kind of philosophical critique in which it's all very well for you to claim that you have rights, but even if you are claiming you have rights, it's only because the government believes that they exist. They don't actually exist. If you lived under a government that doesn't believe in them, you're not going to have rights, because it rests on the power of the government to enforce the law.
It's kind of like the Universal Declaration that everyone signed.
Yeah.
It's kind of like everyone signed it, but it's kind of like, well, the unconscious act.
Yeah.
They've got like the Equality Act.
Yes.
It's written in law.
Yeah.
So although they might agree with them, it doesn't technically mean that they have them.
Yes.
They're
so
not,
the,
they're not practiced anywhere.
That's kind of like what Bentham was saying. Of course, this is centuries before that law, but he's kind of saying that. He's saying that rights don't exist really, they're just a made up thing, and the only thing that really exists is the power of the government to enforce law. So if the government wants to enforce human rights, not that he would have used the term human rights, but the rights of man, let's say, that's all well and good, although he criticised it for other reasons that we will look at in a second. But, you know, if you're in a country that doesn't enforce rights, well, tough. You don't have a right to rights. It's up to the government. The government is the one, or the state, is the thing that enforces the rule of society. And if they don't believe in it, then that's more real than your claim to kind of an abstract idea that you have rights.
And rights wouldn't come around if there wasn't social
life. So it's a bit like,
yeah, if you didn't you organically
quite
emerge.
Like quiet,
yeah.
And the only way we've got rights is because we've said that we want them.
Yes.
And
yeah, it's an idea that's spread.
Conflict anyway, because the only way you want change for a conflict. So.
Yeah, well, this is what as a conservative thinker in the broadest sense, this is what Bentham was very much against. He didn't want a revolution in England like there'd been in France, so he was writing against the idea of rights, and also he uses this rights are a form of terrorism.
Didn't even know that was a term.
Well, the word terror was used by people in the French Revolution. I mean, the French Revolution, we still get the benefits of it today, but it was pretty brutal. There were all kinds of atrocities carried out by the people who got into power. Robespierre, I don't know if you've ever heard of anything in the French Revolution. But there were a lot of killings that took place.
That's when the guillotine was invented.
Yeah, I mean, that's it. I mean, they chopped off the aristocrats' heads and all kinds of different people. It was a very violent period, and he didn't want that to happen in England. But it brought more broadly, by terror, the term terror means you use fear to make people do what you want. And parts of the French Revolution, they were open about, we will use terror to make sure that the aristocrats don't rise up against us. Now, they justified that in terms of the rights of man. But you're going into some deep, deep criticisms against rights. Now, by terrorism, what he was referring to is, who are you to demand from the king that you have rights? That's like a form of, you're destabilising society. You're calling forth violence. You're calling forth the destruction of this natural order that we have in England, where the king rules and the aristocracy will look after the poor people as their gentlemanly nature, or whatever you want to call it there. So he thought that was wrong. And maybe you see an aspect of that. You know when people say, oh, rights have gone too far?
Mm.
Maybe you see a little smidgen of that idea with that thought that it's just anyone can claim, I've got rights, and it's against what would be socially accepted. As a conservative thinker, you know, Bentham was very much in favour of the social social harmony in an old-fashioned sense, with the king at the top and everyone knows their place, the classes.
So it's like the natural order of things.
The natural order of things. Remember, natural rights was the king. The king's the king at the top, because you have a king. You look at the natural kingdom, you've got, you know, the most powerful lion or whatever, so you have the most powerful human. Whereas the rights of man turn that on the head and say everyone's equal. I don't know where this phrase comes from, but have you ever heard the phrase "the road to hell is paved with good intentions"? I'm sure she got it from that's kind of what he's saying, and that's what modern criticisms of like communism will say, that the intentions might be good, but you're going to end up, you'll only get to the supposed utopia over an ocean of blood, and you'll never get there anyway. That's what Bentham was saying, that these supposed rights where we'll all be equal, look at France, what they've done, they've been killing people in the thousands. That is bad. We don't want that to happen in England, we want things to carry on, or in general, we don't want rights, we want to be a nice little organic society. Organic, that's something that we'll come to. Because you've got nothing to assert. Yeah. And again, that's a criticism of that kind of conservative view, because you could argue it's a rule of force. The king, or let's just use it that term, the king and his court can just enforce the law as they see fit.
The king and his closest people all have their rights, won't they?
Yeah. But, and everyone else just has... So, exactly, you don't have to... sorry, what was the point you were making?
Like, so if the king's got his rights and his people closest to him, why isn't it?
Yes, because it's entirely arbitrary. The power of the king and the other people is arbitrary. They can do what they want, but everyone else has to jump to their tune. They don't have rights in his model. Well, not that they do. So he would say that, you know, it's up to the grace of the aristocracy to look after everyone. Well, exactly. Well,
like
it was very unfair in that kind of era. Sorry.
It's like a shepherd with a flock.
Yeah. That's what it's an idealised picture of British society at that time, which, you know, there was massive poverty. So, but I suppose what you could say is that the British, going off topic a little bit, the British aristocracy were cleverer in that they gave away their powers bit by bit until we end up with an elected monarch. You know, remember when I was talking about the Prime Minister? So the Prime Minister basically has the powers of a king, but they managed to stay in place, and that led to democracy slowly. Slowly taking place rather than through a bloody revolution, so you could argue that maybe that conservative aspect of doing things slowly bit by bit worked out better.
What happened
in
the French Revolution?
Well, there was the French Revolution, and the leader was called Robespierre, and they took over the country and killed the aristocracy, and they also killed off a lot of the clergy, you know, from the church, because the church had been supporting the king. So they killed people, and they used terror to, they said, we are doing this revolution for the benefit of all mankind, so we are justified to use terror to kill anyone who's going to stop this future that will come around. So they used that, they did that, and there's a famous phrase which I think comes from Robespierre himself, who was the leader. It says, a revolution eats its own children. And what happens is the terror turned suddenly. People who were the leaders then were accused of, right, you're a traitor to the revolution, we better kill you. And Robespierre got accused himself and got his head chopped off. But that rights of man thing, talking about it bubbling up as an idea, that stuck. So the French Revolution, which was supposed to be radically democratic, ended up collapsing. And then you get Napoleon, who was an emperor. He set himself up as an emperor. But the rights were popular amongst the people, and they stuck, and they spread. And they spread to America, and the American Revolution, and the Constitution, and then that spread around the world, sorry?
To the American Revolution as well?
I don't know, was it, in terms of brutality?
Mm. A lot of people were killed.
Yeah.
It's got a history of killing.
Yeah, so...
it's going to be worse.
Okay, so Bentham, British figure, do we understand that criticism he makes of human rights? Okay, so... coming to someone else that we've touched on a little bit again as well. Again, there's a lot of text on there, but I just want you to try and get the gist of it. Maybe that this idea of that idea of herd morality. Right, so Nietzsche He's a fascinating figure. We have touched on him before in other lessons, a big German philosopher. What can I say about Nietzsche in general? Nietzsche is kind of like, he always reminds me of, you know, you get some people that do crazy rants on YouTube or on websites, and write these blogs and no one ever hears of them, and they're just like some kind of little troll. That is how I see Nietzsche, but he got famous. He's like the person who criticises everything and has got quite a dark outlook. But he became, after his death, he became quite famous. Right. So, Nietzsche, again, we've talked on him in ideology. You've heard that phrase, the death of God. Have you heard of God is dead? Right, so Nietzsche, that's famous from him. His Thus Spake Zarathustra is a book that he wrote. And it says, God is dead, which is what people usually pick up on. But the rest of the sentence is, well, God is dead, and there won't be enough blood to wipe away, to wash away all the there won't be enough water to wash away all the blood. Because if God's dead, then it'll lead to this radical kind of conflict between values, different values that people have. And what Nietzsche said, he was a critic of Christianity, and he was a critic of equality. Sorry, I'm just getting a phone call from a member of staff. Hi, Bridget. Are they down in the box? I've got them here. Sorry.
I'm in the room.
I'll let them in. I'm in P209. I've got them. Okay, so right, Nietzsche did not believe in equality at all. He was what was called an aristocratic thinker. I mean, what he thought was pretty brutal, because he believed that some people, like in a deep sense, were inherently superior and deserved to live more than others.
A bit twisted.
Yeah. What he claimed that rights were part of what he called a herd morality. So what happens is you've got the powerful people like the emperors, etc., and they're the brilliant people of history. They're the amazing people of history, and they should be allowed to live exactly how they wish. Whereas you get the masses, the weak people, you know, as he would have put it. And more harsh than that, they want rights because they're weak. They need a legal framework to make themselves all equal to each other. But that the masses of people are worthless, basically, in his estimation. And it's only the strong people that deserve to flourish, and they should not be held back by anything. And that rights are life-denying, because they sort of level everyone down. They make everyone equal. He was fundamentally against the idea of equality. Where would he have been? Well, he was kind of a misfit guy who wandered around Germany. Right, he was a philosopher. He probably thought he was superior because he was a genius. I mean, he was a professor at the age of 21. But he was an odd character, obviously a very odd character. So where would he have been? Well, he was kind of not very high socially, but obviously believed himself to be like a superior intellect. So that's why he thought he was superior.
So like false clash consciousness then.
What do you mean by that? Yeah.
So like he thinks he's all that, but isn't that actually that impressive? He's still as low as everyone else that he makes out to go on.
There is a way to critique him, and I'll come to that in a minute. But so he was. I mean, I'm not taking that away from him. I mean, if you read his writings as well, the other thing that he's considered one of the best prose writers in German writing. I mean, if you read his books, they're incredibly poetic. He doesn't just write sort of like a theory textbook. It's all sort of poetry and stuff, but little aphorisms, like little factual or little thoughts that have come to him. But he is a sort. He obviously died before that, but he's very much become. There's a lot of people that sort of take it away from that, and I think you can. But which political movement do you think may have adopted some of his ideas in the 20th century? The Nazis, yeah. The Overman. Have you ever heard of the Übermensch? The Nazis had this idea of the Übermensch, the Overman, mm-hmm. who was going to be like the superior human, who would be really strong and strong-willed and just powerful. That's what they wanted to create. And he, not quite in that sense, but he created that term, the Overman, which they adopted. What he meant by that was someone who is strong enough to stand up against the suffering of life and be their own sort of artist, if you like, and your life should be like a work of art and you should create your own, but the main criticism of Nietzsche that you can make, I think, and having this is what I've read, is okay, so you can accept that people have different abilities. Some people, might be smarter than others, some people might be great artists, some people might be, better looking than others, and you shouldn't denigrate people for what skills they have. But that is not what it makes people fundamentally equal. What makes people fundamentally equal is not whether they've got better skills than other people, it's because they are human beings that share a common equality. That is nothing to do whether someone's smarter than another person or whether someone's got more money than another person. And that is, for example, the thing that I was reading was, well, would you consider Nelson Mandela to be someone who is part of the herd mentality or life denying? No, that was a great person who worked to make other people's lives better. Nietzsche is very much about you look down on everyone, you're superior in some way, you look down on everyone, whereas what you could say is, the good person helps others, and that's better, because they're not only living their life to the full, so to speak. Like you could say Nelson Mandela lived his life to the full, but he didn't do it in order to make himself look good and everyone else look crap. He did it to help others, to make life better. Do you know what I'm referring to, Nelson Mandela? Sometimes people don't. But how does that stand? That it's kind of going beyond this idea that everyone's kind of trying to drag each other down, because you can be a great person, or just in your everyday life, by helping others, that actually makes things better for everyone and yourself.
Should be valued on what?
Yeah. Yes.
Because as well, a lot of people haven't got the opportunities they have through money or through the opportunities that they're given. Like, someone could equally be as good, not have the same opportunities.
You can critique it on a more radical level of equality, rather than. Yeah, the chances that you were born with. I mean, because to a certain extent, that's just random. If you were born into wealth, or you were born and you were like a genius, that's a random thing about you. It's not something that you've earned. The criticism of Nietzsche is it's still possible to live your life fully without having to trample on other people. And that there's more equality about human beings than, just whether one person's got this skill or not this skill. Any other thoughts on this? So he was against rights in a more general sense too. I mean, this is way before the Universal Declaration. Okay, so that's Nietzsche. How are we doing? Who's the next person who's a critic of everything that we've come to?
Karl Marx.
Yeah. So before I go on to that, what do you think Karl Marx's criticisms of rights might be?
Rights are to benefit the working class, because they exploit the lower.
Yeah, that's basically it. Again, there's going to be a lot of text on here. Don't expect you to write it all down. Okay. So let me go through what Marx's idea was. Right. I suppose that quote is the good thing if you can read that. So there's a few things. Human rights. Let's see if we can unpick this famous phrase. So it's a bit, it's old-fashioned kind of language, but human rights are the rights of egoistic man, of man as a member of bourgeois society. That is to say, an individual separated from his community and solely concerned with self-interest. Quite a, it's not in how we would express ourselves today. anything that comes from that? I mean, I know you've just seen it. Well, I'll come back to that. Right, so basically there's a few things that you can pick out from that and others. So as you were saying, Colin, so Reich's language, he would argue that it hides the exploitation in a capitalist society. So we all, let's say, by this time, and he's writing in England, so there's quite a well-developed body of law in England. So you're free and you're a worker and you freely enter into a contract and shake hands and get it all signed. It's all perfectly legal that you're going to work for the capitalist. But he would argue that legal contract, which you're supposedly equaling, masks a totally unequal relationship. Because you're the worker, you have to sell your labour, your body, if you like, your bodily work, to the capitalist. You've got to do that in order to survive. You've got to do that literally to get food to put in your mouth to keep your body going. Whereas the capitalist, he's not equal with you, he's way above you, because he has power over you, he can sack you at will. So he can use, I mean, this might not be consciously, but, you know, he can use that social power to make you work harder, to exploit you more, because you've got to give everything to him to get food into your mouth, whereas he can just replace you with someone else. He can sack you and get another worker. So even though it might look like you're an equal person going into a contract with an employer, you're not. You're really unequal. And that's at the basis of capitalist society, because it's based on the capitalist, so Marx would say, keeping working you and keeping the profits that you should earn yourself, taking that from you and keeping that for themselves. Again, there's that basic idea that there's no real equality in capitalist society, because it's those with money that have the most power. Also, something that we've picked up on before, so this idea that positive rights, like the right to food, water, shelter, work, are more important than what are called bourgeois, what he called bourgeois rights. When I've got this word bourgeois, do you know what that means? Yeah. The rich people, the upper middle classes and the owners of businesses, etc., and that, those people. So the bourgeois rights are the rights that, you know, a rich person's not bothered about shelter or food or money or that kind of stuff. They've got plenty of that. All they're bothered about is the freedom of speech, let's say, freedom of expression, and that's all well and good, but at the end of the day, you know, there's people struggling just to get food, and that should come first over the bourgeois rights, as Marx would put it. And how does this link in with Marxism then? So Marxism, communism called for a revolution, like the French Revolution, they called for a revolution to overthrow capitalism. And linking in with that positive right, so if you're a rich landowner that exploits, or a rich factory owner that exploits your working class, and they were to rise up against you and try and take back the factory or get themselves more pay, you know, the bourgeois factory owner might say, no, you can't do this, you've violated my contract, I'm going to bring in the police and get you all thrown in jail. Whereas what Marx is saying is, forget all that crap, you are starving, you should rise up against... You should forget about all these bourgeois rights. These rights come first. And if you're starving or you've got no money, you know, you've got no place to live, you should rise up and form a revolution and take what's yours, because the boss has only got his money because he's exploited your work. Your work makes the money. That would be Marx's idea. Now, there is a massive danger in here, and again, if we're linking back to the French Revolution, because did the countries that claimed to be communist, that claimed to be based on Marx's works, did they have very good human rights records?
No.
No, they had absolutely appalling human rights records. In fact, the countries that claimed to be communist killed way more people than Hitler did. Now, you might say that wasn't real communism, but you could also say that, well, wherever it's been tried, it's had a similar outcome. What defence I might make of it is that the ideal is good, but when it gets into power, it becomes bad.
So,
Yeah. So, I mean, you could say Marx, this is where it gets dodgy, because Marx is, if you overthrow the bourgeois rights, like these rights, then you're going to end up with a dictatorship. Even if your intentions are to bring about the equality and welfare of everyone, you know, if you're starting to throw people in prison without a trial because they're counter-revolutionary, you're going to end up with people just getting murdered in a jail cell, which is what happened in the Soviet Union, etc. So my thoughts about that would be, while I kind of agree with the aims, it's very dangerous in practice. Or it's good if kind of these kind of ideas are oppositional and people are saying, always remind you, capitalism tends to exploit people, but it can be dangerous when it gets into power because they don't really believe in the bourgeois rights, but they're not really bourgeois rights because people, anyone of class can appeal to them. Any thoughts about that then, Marx and rights? So in a sense, you could say that it's almost going beyond them and saying, well, you can't get bogged down in these kind of bourgeois rights, you need to focus on these ones, the most important. Any other thoughts about Marx's ideas?
I just think it, like with the bourgeois rights, like in work and stuff, you either have them or not have them. So although it's a good principle, you're better off with them because you're never going to get out of the capitalist, you know.
Yeah.
It's not going to change, so you're better off just getting what you can get and trying to fight it because you have to have a massive evolution for it to change.
So we get that. So does that maybe translate that into what he's saying is that what human rights do, they make everyone into little atomised individually that supposedly enter into contracts with each individual person, but that's not how it should be. It should be a kind of, it's almost like a left-wing version of what Bentham said, and that people shouldn't be separated into their little rights. They should feel each other as a society that wants to help each other and make everyone equal, rather than you're the boss, I'm the worker. We enter into a relationship with each other through a contract. Okay. Right, so moving on to a more up-to-date version of a criticism of human rights. Has anyone heard of postmodernism? So I don't want to go into this too much detail, but can anyone tell me a little bit? I mean, I'm going to summarise, but can anyone tell me
more? Sorry, our society is more less restrained, it's less secular, so it's more equal.
Certainly that's part of postmodernism, yeah. There's a more radical part of it which is links back to a bit of kind of Nietzschean, but we'll come back to that. Right. So the postmodern critique of human rights. Right. Postmodernism, it's a philosophical viewpoint. And what it has, it's sceptical of all grand narratives. Have you ever heard of the term grand narratives? Or big ideas, if you want to put it in a more big ideas. Right, so it claims that all big ideas in history and society are just a smokescreen for controlling people. So they would say religion, I mean, that's an obvious one. That's a really crude way of looking at it, but that's for the sake of argument, they would say religion is not, it's a way of controlling people. It's a grand narrative, a big idea, but it's a way of controlling people. Well, they would go even further, way, 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 way even further than that. They would say that human rights and many other different things, well, let's just say that human rights are a fake grand narrative. And they would use these kind of words that it's the particular construction of dead white men. So human rights, rich dead white men, work in favour, I don't mean individually, I mean sort of as a world historical movement, that through history, if you were to look for rights, that is what it's all about benefiting, and especially when it goes to other countries, that it's all about the rich white men or rich dead men, white dead men that control most of the Western countries, and then it's linked with capitalism, so to speak, and it's about exploiting people, and it's about exporting that model whereby we're all little atomised communities where we just enter into contract with each other, which makes us really ripe for exploitation by capitalism. And I mean, you know, postmodernists go way deep in their criticisms. Not that I'm saying that they're right about that. I'm just presenting these things at the moment. So they would. I mean, one of the criticisms that human rights would make is what's called a critique of instrumental reason. And what they mean by that is they mean a criticism of reason itself, logic itself. Because what they argue is that reason and logic, trying to figure things out, and it's all manipulation of the world of other people. So if you link reason and logic with science and technology, it's not a good thing. It's about exploiting nature. We use science and technology to exploit other people. So reason itself is a bad thing. Well, if you haven't got reason, what else have you got? Seems to me like you've just got madness. But if you can't, you know, I'm unpacking a lot of things. Any questions or thoughts about that? They're basically saying that all big ideas are for the benefit of someone exploiting someone else. Well, they would put it as the oppressed against the oppressor, whatever that might be. So for a big one, which might link in with feminism, so to speak, would be you've got the oppressor and the oppressor, you've got patriarchy, and then you've got womanhood, let's say. And patriarchy is a grand narrative which needs to be critiqued, and that might be true. But do we get how it breaks down? It's supposed to be, I mean, this is not, in a sense, there's nothing positive about this. It's just a relentless critique of everything that exists. And some people see this as being a very, very negative way of viewing the world, because you can't function if human beings need a grand narrative in their lives, some would say. Whether that might be religion, or it might be even some idea of personal goal that you're working towards. But if you keep smashing everyone's ideas down, you're going to end up with nihilism, where no one can act or do anything because they just feel like that life's pointless. So what do we think about, A, that postmodern critique in general, for a start? Have I made myself clear on that, or do I need to clarify? Yeah.
I can see the point. I see where
they're
coming from.
So obviously there are where you've got like a big idea or a big project, whether it be a philosophy or some kind of political view, and you could see why that might be used to exploit people. But maybe that's not the intended aim for the whole thing. You know, I mean, I wouldn't say that human rights is about it. It's not just a way for dead white men to.
Yeah,
or living
about how they've been brought about as well,
yeah.
Not doing it
to
anybody
else's. Yeah, so it's like universalised again. It's the idea of human rights is universalised beyond. And again, this idea of the dead white men, it might not even be that it's like, oh, these people rubbing their hands, how can we exploit people? But it's because they would say it's because of implicit biases that the people.
It's probably then encouraged because they might see somebody doing gender for it, but I think it wouldn't have started for that purpose.
Yeah.
So, like, politicians and stuff might have then had an idea of where it can get out of it, but it won't have started for that.
But again, how and that's linking in, so how the idea of human rights has been, or not human rights, but rights and then evolving into human rights has been around for centuries. So, how does someone rub their hands and say, right, for nearly 1,000 years I'm going to make sure this evolves in this way so I can get my money or whatever like that, my ancestors. It won't work like that. Which is, again, another critique when people make lazy critiques of religion in general. I would argue when they just say, oh, it's all about exploitation. It can't just be, because it propagates across generations. There must be something to it that is good for people, whether you believe in it or not. Yeah. Okay, so if we're just talking about rights, they would defend the idea that rights are culturally relative. And I'll come to that. So when I mean culturally relative, that, you know, it's different in how we see things is different to how people in China see things, or how people in Saudi Arabia see things, and that's just fine. If, you know, they probably wouldn't say it out like this, but they might. But the idea would be, well, if that's how society is in Saudi Arabia, chop your hand off for stealing a Mars bar, that's them. We can't go around forcing our ways.
It needs to be like that.
Mm.
So the way I see it is we're just more evolved than the countries, and kind of like when we look at other countries, it's like we're looking at us, but in like hundreds of years ago.
Yeah.
We're just more evolved than,
And I think that's true, that countries are evolving, not all at the same rate and towards exactly the same point, but they are sort of going down. There is some kind of goal to it, because it appeals to a lot of people.
You can't judge one end and the other, because they're all at different rates and positions and globalisation and stuff like that.
But I think human rights is different in the fact that when we see these groups rising up, like Raif Badawi in Saudi Arabia, you know, he knew what that language of human rights was, and he took it on himself and said, I'm not going to allow this to happen, and it turned into a big movement around him, and it managed to get him at least not being whipped openly to having it done on his shirt and stuff, and maybe he'll get out. Okay, right, so this then links into this next sort of criticism. We're going to look at that, that's a thing. Right, so criticism, cultural imperialism. Right, and I want to look at an example of this. Right, so we'll do a little activity with this in a minute. Right, so cultural imperialism, what do you think is meant by that, bearing in mind what we've just discussed? That human rights are a form of cultural imperialism.
How they're adopted with other
societies? Yeah, so basically the idea that the Western countries are forced or trying to force human rights on other countries. Okay. So this is from, there's two things I want to look at. So, again, I don't expect you to write this down. So in 1947, when the Human Rights Act was being developed, the Saudi delegation... cultural imperialism. So basically the idea that the Western countries are forcing their ideas onto other cultures. Yeah, so... 1947, there were a big conference to come up with the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which was signed in 1948. Saudi Arabia has signed it since, but they abstained, along with several other countries, along with, let's remember this, many of the Soviet communist countries, they didn't sign it at first. And what the Saudi delegation did, they sort of did this report afterwards, and they said, we've abstained from signing the UDHR because... the process by which it's come about is taking into consideration only the standards recognised by Western civilization, and ignored more ancient civilizations which are past the experimental stage, and the institutions of which, for example, marriage had proved their wisdom through the centuries. It was not for the committee to proclaim the superiority of one civilization over all others. So, regardless of any value judgment on it, that is from a different society, a traditional society, saying why they disagreed with some of the human rights that were put forward. And then, so that's sort of Saudi Arabia. And then what you have is this East Asian, sort of Chinese, Singapore, those kind of countries that are quite traditional. And they've criticised the individualism of human rights because what they say is more important is not the individual, it's the harmonious society. So again, a bit like Bentham. They say that, there was a quote that I was going to put in by Lee Kuan Yew, who was this long-time president of Singapore, which might sound obscure, but what Singapore is, it's a massively rich country in East Asia that has a democracy in a sense, but one party has been in rule for like 50-odd years. And he was the president of that, and he ruled the country for decades. And what he said was, well, yes, we've got some things that make things more efficient, you know, like we've got a democracy, so to speak, we're not an outright dictatorship. But you can't just say what you want, you can't just live as you want, you can't just go around being outrageous. What's more important for us in Singapore is that we all recognise our place in society, we all behave in a manner which is conducive to the benefit of society rather than the individual. We don't want all this chaos. We don't want people on drugs like in America. We don't want all this family problems. We just want what is important for us is that society comes first, not the individual. And that's helped us become rich and prosperous. Now, what's dangerous about that is, I think, as China, because China have a similar attitude towards things, as China becomes the richest country in the world, which it will in your lifetimes, it will overtake America in about 30 years' time, will we in the West start thinking like that? Will we start curtailing our rights to think, right, we can't become poor because China, look at China, they don't allow freedom of speech, they don't allow all these things, and look how they're developing, so we better start cracking down on our rights, and just we need to make sure everyone toes the line and everyone's working real hard. We don't want any complaints. Well, perhaps if we're leaving the European Convention on Human Rights and we get this Brit of Bill. I think it would be harder in America because it's part of the Constitution. But that is where a danger could come with the UK. The opposite thing to think is, which is another powerful argument, is that rights will continue to spread into places like China, because what happens is, or the theory goes, that as you get a richer country, you get more middle class people, you get better educated people, they don't want to be told what to do by the government. They want they're educated people, they're intelligent people. They think for themselves, so democracy might spread the other way. China might have another revolution like that tried to happen in 1989, with the guy who tank, that thing that I showed you. That was an uprising to try and bring democracy about. So maybe China will develop to a point, and then there'll be probably some kind of crisis that the government can't handle, and the public will rise up and say, no, you guys can't do it. We want democracy, we want choice in our leaders. I think that's, I hope and I think that's more likely than the opposite. Because that seems to be what happens.
What's the gap like in China?
It's massive. So they're massively rich. Well, they're getting rich and richer as a country, as a whole, because there's so many. If you look at your phone, it's made in China, etc. But because there's so many people, the average wage is still like £3,000 a year. Because even though there's millions and millions of people that live in cities, they're still quite poor compared to us, most people. I mean, there are billionaires in China and more and more rich people, but there are people that are still like peasants. Half the population still lives out in the countryside, farming and stuff. Mm-hmm. So it's got. But that's the thing. Just imagine when they're all at our level of development, how rich they will be as a country. I mean, it's crazy what they're doing. They're building.
Like how well off they are now,
Once they. In economic terms, develop what's called effective demand, which is you can get developed to a certain point by churning out cheap goods on cheap wages, but then you have to make people rich in your own country so they can buy all the stuff too. Mm-hmm. So they're rich enough to buy an iPad or whatever. Yeah, so you have to do that to become developed as a country. So I think they're pretty clever and they know what they're doing. And then they're trying to outsource all their cheap labour to Africa. So who's going to be...
Yeah, they're trying to put all the factories over there.
Yeah. Yeah, and they can raise up their own population. I mean, they're doing all kinds of... They're building a city. I forget what it's called. It's called something like... I can't remember what it's called. It's like three syllables. And it's going to be a city of 60 million people. That's the entire population of Britain in a city. It's going to be between... They're basically going to build this city between... It's like between Beijing, Shanghai and another one. And it's going to amalgamate them all into this one mega city of 60 million people. Yeah, so
what's
could you imagine?
Mega city now, 10 million?
Yeah. Jesus. So, yeah. And they would say, we've done that because, if we need to build a motorway that's going to help develop our economy as a whole, we'll just get everyone will leave. There won't be any to and fro
in because of the human rights and stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like in Keighley, in Keighley they're trying to put a dual carriageway in where McDonald's is.
Oh my God.
And there's a row of houses and there's a couple of people that have objected to it. And rightly their views have to be taken into account. In China, if that was 10,000 people that lived along the stretch where they need to build it, they'd just build it. They'd just kick everyone out. Probably build them a flat, but it'd be awful compared to where they lived. And it's like where they've built all these big dams. They just flooded these dams, and hundreds of thousands of people had to leave these valleys where people lived for centuries. And just thought, well, there's a flat in that city. You lived in this nice countryside, but now you've got a flat, so I'm going to live there.
It's like when they're trying to destroy, like, shiny towns and stuff.
Mm.
And it's like, they say they're going to build all these places, but there's never going to be enough room for everybody, and they're never going to be that great.
Mm.
So it's kind of like these people, like, you can't destroy it because this is, like, a little community, and they're just going to come in like that.
Mm. But the Chinese government would say, we're doing that for the benefit of the nation as a whole, and that comes first, not the individual. Which is kind of the opposite to the way we see things. Okay. So, what I was going to ask us to do for the last 5 minutes before we take a little break. You've got this Cairo Declaration here. What this was, in 1990, some countries from sort of the Middle East got together and they put together their own declaration. What I would like you to do is, if you've got that, you know, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights that I gave out. Well, you might be able to get it on your iPad, or maybe I could nip in. So what I'd just like you to do is try and just, you know, not in massive detail, but just compare them side by side. Maybe I've got some spare ones. Let's go. Just have a look at those and see which ones match up and which ones don't, just for 5 minutes, please. Yeah, this was the one that was by these various Middle Eastern countries. They put forward their own version in 1990.
When was
that? That was in 1948. Look quite different than what these are.
What does that really mean? The true religion is the guarantee of what encompasses such dignity.
Which one's that?
The first one.
Article 1.
Like the last sentence. Is that what's coming in a few years?
So that means that in these countries, Islam will be the state religion. So that is the death penalty for certain crimes.
So that is allowed?
Yeah. So just while we're coming towards the end of this, I mean, the main difference that I could see is in Article 9, which basically, that is against freedom of religion or freedom of expression. So that's probably the main difference, particularly Part B. Sorry, Article 10. That's what I meant. So, if we were looking at the Human Rights Act, Universal Declaration of Human Rights, that would go against the right to freedom of religion. So what that would mean is, say in Saudi Arabia, any have you ever heard the term proselytizing, which is where you try and convince people to join your religion, which is a human right, part of freedom of religion, freedom of speech. Thinking of Saudi Arabia, that's not allowed. You cannot proselytize. That would be prohibited. You can't. It is, but that's what all religions. I mean, Christianity, Jehovah's Witnesses. Islam do that. They try and get converts. Not all religions do that. Hinduism, Judaism doesn't actually try and get converts. But that's saying that under their rules, you would not be allowed to have freedom of speech, freedom of expression, because even just showing that someone's of a particular religion might encourage someone to join that religion or to not believe a religion. Yeah. Okay, so that's just to show you a little bit of contrast there. So we'll take a break now.